folks, welcome back to the third episode of Throat Punch Lunch. No throat punches are going to be given. Keep your eye out for Bauer, though. He likes to do that to himself a lot. But anyway, hey, I've got no less than 15 segments for you today. And we all did that under 60 minutes. So I'm staying to that 3 to 4 minute time frame that I promised I would stay to. Although a couple of my contributors are starting to stray from that 3 to 4 minute window, except for Lance. He's doing a great job of staying around that 5 minute. We don't want to ask too much of him. Thank you so much, Undead Viking. Anyway, I've got a lot of segments. Your guys are here for that, not me. Let's get to it.
They said it couldn't be done, a 5 minute video from Undead Viking. Yes, that's what it is, and I'm gonna prove them wrong one throat punch lunch at a time. Arkham Horror, let's talk about it. In the short amount of time that I have, there's absolutely no way I'm going to be able to describe Arkham Horror to you. There are tons of resources that you can find. You can find my age-old video of it that I made years ago on the Board Game Geek and what have you. But this is an awesome game, and this is a quintessential Ameritrash game, and it is an Ameritrash treasure. Now, why is that? Well, this is the first game that taught me why having a bead organizer, or a Plano box, or whatever you want to call them, is a necessity for these games. Look at all these tons of little tiny bits and dice and all these little like character standees and stuff. Now, I have a buddy who has actually gone out and purchased like every single one of the Arkham Horror miniatures that they sold. I didn't do that. I thought he was crazy. But luckily, he comes over and we use those when we play. You know, little, you know, money. I love these little tiny money cardboard tokens. I've always liked those. I have no idea why. I just think they look cool. But also, tons and tons of decks of cards with bunches of information on each and every one of the cards. Now everybody's probably screaming at this point, ah, rubber bands around cards, you heathen. Well, this is an Ameritrash game. It can take it. It can handle it. Don't worry about it. This is a stroke of brilliance on my part. I found a cheap bag dice. I think it was from Crystal Cast. After I got the dice, I took this, and this is the monster bag. So, like, when you run into monsters in Arkham Horror, I use this cool skull bag, and then, like, you draw the monsters out of here. So let's see what I got here. I got a Night Gaunt. You know, cool. Well, you know, and like I said, I'm not going to go into everything about how you play this game, but you know, Ameritrash to me is heavily themed. It is tons of, it's a giant board. I mean, I don't even have all my expansions out because they just wouldn't fit on this 3-foot table that I have in my game room slash studio, if you will. But all kinds of like writing all over this thing. You know, it's like there's no way this is language independent, you know, so they have to translate it to other languages, which they've done, which is cool. You have these giant rule books that, you know, have gone through major rewrites over and over again, and people still have rules questions about it because, you know, they just it's a tough game to learn. You have to kind of like get through. Then you have expansion rule books that are almost as long as the rule book for the base game itself. And you have a really cool box, obviously. But and then the coolest thing that I like about, well, I shouldn't say like the coolest thing that I like about it, because I mean I like everything pretty much equally about Arkham Horror. But obviously you have the big bad guys, and all these different creatures, all these great old ones have their own different powers and abilities. And that's another thing about Ameritrash games that, you know, is really indicative, how variable player powers, lots of different variables as far as what you're facing, but very modular. You can swap things in and out of these games, and the function of the game remains the same, but you're just changing how certain rules react. Of course, this is Yig. This is easy mode. If you're going to play the game, remember that, because you can actually like shotgun him to death, which is kind of ridiculous. But obviously, you know, Shub-Niggurath, Azathoth, absolute destruction. If Azathoth awakens, the game is over, and the investigators lose, because obviously Azathoth is the bringer of the end, or the Hast, or Ithaqua. You know, so you have all these cool, and I'll find there he is, the big, great, bad Cthulhu, and Yarladep Sothaga, and there you go, Yog-Sothoth. The very first game of this I ever played, we went up against Yog-Sothoth, and we got our heads handed to us, because why? Because if you did not, any investigator with no gate trophies is devoured. And none of us had a gate trophy. And so, like, the Yogg-Soth came out, and we were all trying to figure out how we're going to defeat it. And, well, no, we don't even get a chance, because we all just got eaten alive. And, of course, you have the tons and tons and tons and tons and tons of different players that people can be, each with their different powers and their abilities and what have you. And this, you know, stuff like that, it's all of the differences, all of the millions of monsters, the millions of chits, the tons of dice, the fact that you can play an entire game and do everything exactly right over the course of several hours, and the game will come down to one final die roll. And whether or not one of your friends rolls a 5 or a 6 is going to determine whether or not you win the game. We just lost. You rolled a 3. But you know what? You still had a blast, because even though the world ended, you still had a great story and a great time. So there you go. That is Arkham Horror. That is the game that got me into the hobby. And that is why, pretty much, why I'm doing this video right now. Anyway, that was Ameritrash Treasures. I'm the Undead Viking. I hope you had an awesome time. I know I did. I'm going to go play this now. Take care.
It's Mark Zielinski, and I am so excited that Sam asked me to join you guys here over on Throat Punch Lunch. Many of you may know me. I've been on the Dice Tower audio podcast for over 9 years, and I've also been on other podcasts and video casts over the interwebs over the years. Currently, I'm also a co-host on the Countercharge podcast. Now, one of the reasons that Sam asked me to join you guys here on the show is because I am a longtime gamer and I have a wide range of games that I like to play. I also like to do modeling and I also like to do hobby projects. So there's a lot of variety that I think I'm going to try to bring to the show here for you. So I like to play old games. I like to play new games. I like to play Hex and Counter War games. I like to play Euro games. I like to play collectible card games. I like to play miniature tabletop war games. I mean, you name it, I like to play it, and it's either on my table nearby or I'm going to play it at a convention. I really don't care. I just love to play games. So some of the things we're going to cover here on my segment in Throat Punch Lunch, we're definitely going to cover one of my favorite Hex and Counter War games, and that is Advanced Squad Leader Starter Kit. This is a fantastic beginning game. Yes, it's derived from Advanced Squad Leader, but don't let that scare you. This is a great game, and we're going to cover this one. Oh, another game that we're going to cover is also going to be Kings of War. Yes, this is the subject of the Countercharge podcast, but this is the preeminent rank and flank miniature war game in the fantasy area today, and it is a great game, simple rules, fast fun. You're going to enjoy it. I also picked up a bunch of stuff at the Origins Game Fair that we're going to be covering, and I'm going to cover a little bit of painting and a little bit of project. I know we've got a lot of painting and projects here on Throat Punch Lunch already, but the thing I'm going to do is a little bit different, and it's going to be really for the aspiring tournament gamer that's out there, and then also just if you want to do something for your board games, and I don't want to spoil it because we'll be talking about it soon enough. So anyways, I am really excited to be here. I can't wait to be with you guys every other week here on Throat Punch Lunch, and until next time, take care.
Hey folks, welcome back to another Canvas segment on Throat Punch Lunch. Today, our Canvas subject hails from Sao Paulo, Brazil. And his name is John Pereiro. His name is actually not John, that's just the English equivalent of it. But John sends me some subject footage that I'm really happy to show you, because not only is it my favorite game, but it's really, really cool. Let's check this out. John said that he has always had a love of sci-fi space operas, and hey, what better game is there for that than good old TI3? He loved the game so much that he wanted to make it even more epic, so he started with painting the miniatures and making home systems for all of the races. And then he replaced all the tokens with 3D miniatures and scratch-built the flagships for all of the alien races. The planets are all made from styrofoam balls with an acrylic piece on top that shows the planet's name and attributes. The first time he played the game, though, he realized that the pieces that he had created for it were too big and made the board too crowded. So, the next year, he actually built larger board pieces cut in MDF. And so, so since then, there have been no less than three epic matches, and they all have lasted about 16 hours on average. He basically leaves off with saying that besides his love for the game and its theme, the game sessions are great opportunities to simply gather his friends together for a few hours, he says, and then be transported to this new world, this distant planets, and they can fight space battles and all of that kind of stuff. So he just really enjoys the game for the camaraderie of it. And so we say to him, kudos to you and your game group. So thank you, John, for sharing with us your copy of Twilight Imperium 3. That is probably the coolest thing that I have seen in a very long time. I'd love to be able to play Twilight Imperium 3 with that copy, although that is probably would require me traveling to Sao Paulo, Brazil, and I can't do that. But if it ever happens, I'm going to be looking you up, John. So anyway, if any of you guys want to send in your stuff that you've done, again, it doesn't have to be painting, it doesn't have to be anything like that, just something where you have taken your hobby gaming to the next level and you've gotten a lot of enjoyment or quality family time or whatever out of it, you can send me from right here. Send me your contact information, and we'll get together and talk about it and get you on one of the future episodes of The Canvas. Until next time, we'll see you on the flip side.
Hello again. I'm Jeremiah Acevedo, the Board Game Renegade, and welcome to another edition of Taking Out the Trash. As we all know, Ameritrash games are centered around theme, and I love thematic games. Some of my favorite thematic games happen to be cooperative games. Let me show you a few. Here is Pandemic. In Pandemic, you are preventing a global pandemic. Here is Legendary Encounters. In Legendary Encounters, you are preventing an alien horde from entering your ship and pretty much killing you. And then we have Bomb Squad. In Bomb Squad, you are trying to disarm bombs in real time. Now, I could consolidate all of these into smaller packages and drop them into my backpack. However, we're going to do something different this time. I'm going to substitute these games with games of the same or similar themes. Here we go. Instead of Pandemic, I could bring Pandemic the Cure. Instead of Legendary Encounters, I could bring Space Hulk Death Angel. Instead of Bomb Squad, I could bring Fuse. Now, these packages are small enough, but let's see if we could consolidate these a little better to take them with me wherever I go. Here's everything that comes in all three games, and as you can tell, there aren't any large components here. However, there is a lot of stuff, a bunch of dice, a lot of cards, some cardboard, even two dice bags. And when you take games with you wherever you go, you just want to leave anything that's not necessary behind, and you want to maximize space. The games also come with the rule books, and like I mentioned last time, download the PDF files to these and leave them at home. They're unnecessary. Now let's see what else we can do to save some space with these. There are two dice bags that are roughly the same size. You're only going to be playing one game at a time, so you only need one of these. So I'll choose the fuse bag and I'll put the other one aside. I love plastic baggies for traveling with games. They help keep everything organized. You should always keep plastic baggies on hand. When I travel with multiple games, I make sure that components of different games are in different bags. I don't like bunching them together. Could you imagine having to sort all of these dice right before you play a game? That would suck. When traveling with cards, I like using rubber bands, and I love my games, so these rubber bands are put on very loosely. They're just on to keep the cards from being displaced while I'm mobile with them. When traveling with the game, if you have any components that you could disassemble, do so, because they could potentially save you some crucial space. Now I think that everything would actually fit into the fuse box. However, I'm going to take the insert out first, because that's just taking up unnecessary space. There you go. Almost everything is inside of the single box. Make sure that when you're putting multiple games into a box, you're playing Tetris with it, moving everything around and trying different methods. Don't ram everything in there and just shove it in there. You're going to ruin your components. Just take your time, and I'm sure you could make everything fit. Now with the little loose components here, we just place them so that they fit comfortably. Let's put the dice bag on top there. And then we could just box it up. And the final touch, as always, is a loose rubber band around it so that the box doesn't open while I'm moving around with it. So there you go, folks. We have all three of these thematic cooperative games in this single box. And now it's ready to go into my backpack or into your glove box, and we can head to wherever we're going to play some games. This has been Taking Out the Trash. Thank you for watching.
Board Game Geek Glossary defines Ameritrash games as games that emphasize a highly developed theme, characters, or factions with individually defined abilities, player-to-player conflict, and usually a moderate to high level of luck. So at its core, Ameritrash games are all about theme. Many designers build worlds, lore, and stories that are then incorporated into a game. As players, we need to learn about these new worlds and lore in order to really get into the game. But what if you could sit down and play a game with a theme that you're already familiar with? A game that contains images, characters, and locations that you already know from other media such as books, TV shows, and movies? Well, with board games based on intellectual property, you can. Intellectual property, or IP, is defined as a work that is a result of creativity, such as a manuscript or design, to which one has rights, and for which one may apply for a patent, copyright, trademark, etc. So, when a board game company wants to publish a game based on popular stories or characters they don't own, they must first get rights from those who own the IP in order to produce and publish the games. And the reason they want to produce games based on IP is because they know there will be many consumers in the marketplace that will be interested in playing a game with a theme that they are a fan of. Examples of some popular thematic games based on IP include Game of Thrones, Battlestar Galactica, The Legendary Encounter Series, War of the Ring, Imperial Assault, XCOM, and Firefly.
Take my love, take my land, take me where I cannot stand.
Each of these games will have a draw from a segment of gamers that are already familiar with the IP they are based on. And when the mechanics of the game are well integrated with the theme, then the game will be set to provide a very memorable experience for the players. For example, in Game of Thrones 2nd Edition, you play as one of the powerful families of Westeros trying to take control of the land in effort to sit upon the Iron Throne. Players familiar with the George R.R. Martin novels will recognize location, characters, and themes which will help them to be drawn into a game based on intrigue, political drama, and warfare. Another example is Battlestar Galactica, where players take on roles of one of the characters from the most recent television series. Each character has their own role and unique abilities, but just like the TV show, not all the Cylons look like toasters, as some of the players are secretly working against the humans to keep them from reaching their final destination. In games like these, people familiar with the IP will quickly find a connection with the game, which help create a more in-depth experience. However, be forewarned that not all games based on IP are necessarily good. Many times the IPs are slapped onto a game without much thought on how to integrate the IP into the game beyond some artwork and references. It's like movies that are made based on video games. Many may look good, but once you see it, you realize it's more about making money than making a good movie. I can't carry it for you, but I can carry you. When a well-known IP is merged with a sound game design, it allows a player to become immersed in the game. You'll draw upon your knowledge of the IP in order to become more and more engaged with the game and the other players. As a result, this will help create experiences you will talk about and share with others long after the game is back on the shelf. In upcoming segments, I'll look at ways to enhance your Ameritrash game sessions with elements beyond the board game itself. In the meantime, I'd love to hear which games you think best exemplify a well-known IP, and what IPs would you love to see incorporated into a board game? Let me know in the comments.
Too soon.
This week, my awesome sauce is about a game that we have played a lot. You've seen it a lot of live plays, and it's one that is one of Tom's favorites, if not his favorite, is Cosmic Encounter. So I want to talk to you about a little bit of strategy in Cosmic Encounter. There's a lot of things to this game. A lot of it is how well you can negotiate with people. A lot of it is how many times you could be an ally. A lot of it is which person are you going to attack. You know, you kind of want to make friends with people, because if you make enemies, then they might not take you as their ally when you want to be in the ally to get up your pieces. So it's very important in this game to kind of try to work with the other people. Don't pick a power that's too powerful, because people won't work with you if you pick a very powerful race. So it's better to pick a moderate race that could do some cool effects than to pick a very strong race, because if you pick one of the strong races, it's going to be harder to get people to work with you because they see you have a strong race and won't want to help you out to get you points. So I really feel in this game, an important part of it is to negotiate, work with the other players, make sure that you could have a good race. You can get in on those alliances. You can go in and work with the other players to get as many bases as you can. Also negotiate with someone else. You know, if you're a main player, it's important to do that base for base negotiate if you can. And one thing that I strongly believe in this game, which as you've seen recently in our live plays, doesn't always happen, is I don't think you should lie in this game. I know some people do, and they say, oh, let's do a negotiate for negotiate, and then they attack. You guys saw that in one of ours, but I think it's better to just be straight, negotiate, because if you do, then you will hopefully work better and be able to negotiate into other deals later on in the game. So that's how I feel about Cosmic Encounter, just a little bit of strategy on what to do to be successful in the game.
What a good choice for a game!
Awesome sauce.
Hey guys, this is Roy Canne from Epic Gaming Night, and this is Roll With The Punches, where we talk about randomness in games and how it makes a game exciting, and also how you can mitigate and twist randomness into your favor. This week I'm going to be talking about an exciting game that I just finally got to play, and it's got awesome huge miniatures and lots of combat and tons of randomness also. That game is Zombicide Black Plague. Zombicide is your typical hack and slash Ameritrash game. It's cooperative and you're rolling tons of dice for combat. There's tons of item cards that come out that are completely random, and the spawns are all random as well. So let's take a look at a few ways to mitigate some of the randomness that's designed into the game. Picking characters that have abilities that help you mitigate randomness is a great strategy. The Bob character, who is actually from Monty Python and the Holy Grail, normally known as Tim, has an ability where he can re-roll any dice. It's called Lucky, and basically every single action, he's allowed to re-roll the dice once. He has to keep the roll, but that allows for lots of luck mitigation. There are also several items you can find by searching buildings. Lots of arrows and lots of bolts allow you to reroll different ranged combat attacks, so they help you. If you get those poor rolls, you can reroll and hopefully make your attack stick. The spawns are designed to scale depending on the experience level of your characters. So the higher experience and higher level your character is, the more deadly the spawns are going to be. They're tiered, so you have blue, yellow, orange, and red, and the monsters get more difficult as you get higher up. So if you work together as a team to make sure everybody's evenly leveling, that way you can mitigate the strength of the monsters that are coming out, so the randomness on that won't hurt you nearly as bad. I love how Zombicide always just feels like there's swarms of zombies coming at you from all sides. You can definitely get screwed by the randomness of just too many necromancers coming out and them being able to escape because they're on the other side of the board, and you have to focus as a team to try to take care of those things. So sometimes randomness can really screw you up in this game, but hopefully there's a couple things you can do to look and see how to make your characters better, and specifically twist your die rolls or scale things so that it's less just off the wall. This game is very much still very random, but I think it's exciting and it fits the theme, because you never know what's going to happen when you bust down a door and zombies pop up all over the place and you're working together trying to slash things. A good note is don't play with all of the new bosses and abominations and things like that, because there's only a couple cards in the deck and you have to get really lucky to be able to find those that can actually take care of those things. So this has been Roll With The Punches, and we'll see you guys next time.
Hi guys, it's Breach 18 and I'm here on a Thursday busy night at the Dice Cup in Nottingham, Nottingham's very own board game cafe. We're talking about the merger between Ameritrash Games and Euro Games, what I've called Euro Thrash now, turn the phrase. So let's go chat to people. So I'm with Steve.
Hi Jay.
And we're basically talking about when games become hybrid of Euro Thrash and I'm calling it a Euro Thrash, so Ameritrash Euro Thrash. So when do you think games actually become a hybrid?
For me, it'd probably be the mechanics of the game. There's a lot of Ameritrash mechanics you don't see in general Euro games.
Mm-hmm.
So if you've got a Euro game with Ameritrash mechanics, or vice versa, I'd imagine that's where the crossover lies. I'm trying to think of a game. Blood Rage, maybe?
Blood Rage would be
Blood Rage. Yeah? So, and what makes you, personally for you, what makes you think that Blood Rage is a hybrid of the two?
One of the big things, I think, is theme. Euro games are often very light on theme. So if a game can incorporate Euro mechanics with a very strong theme, and Blood Rage does that really well, that is the thing that ticks the box for me.
Yeah, I'm a bit of an Ameritrash fan and not a great Euro fan, but I have to say I do like the sort of hybrid games. This is one, the Blood Rage Eclipse is another one that's often given that
yeah,
kind of...
Yeah, someone did actually
yeah,
mention that.
Yeah, and I mean, I love Eclipse. Another one. So all these games are my sort of favourite games that I play,
right,
so
okay.
I really like these kinds of games that balance the sort of area control warring with the, controlling of resources. Controlling of actions.
It's got to have a fight.
Yeah, it's got to have a fight in it, really.
I don't think it does.
Okay.
Because if it's an Ameritrash game that's strong on theme, that will take precedence over no matter what mechanics are there. The fact that it's a really strong themed game means it is Ameritrash with some just
some
Euro
mechanics. Okay.
The mechanics will always exist, but if you look like at a game like this, this is all mechanics and hardly any theme.
Right.
It's based around something, and you know, the cards are based around that, but you could say this is a toddler party and just change all the names,
yep,
and it's the same game.
Right.
But an Ameritrash, it's all about the theme,
right,
and nothing else. So it doesn't matter what the mechanics are. So you can't have a hybrid.
Okay.
It doesn't exist.
That's really interesting, because I'm sure there's going to be loads of comments on YouTube disagreeing with you, but I think it's a valid point.
I guess if there was that middle ground and it was clear what the middle ground was, it would have a specific name,
yeah,
rather than an Ameritrash or a hybrid.
Yeah.
It would have a specific name, and we don't really have a name for that sort of game.
I just coined a phrase.
We'll keep it for now.
I guess combat games are fairly common for that, or moving more that way, because they're moving away from dice rolling with like Kemet and obviously Blood Rage, that it's card based. So even like Game of Thrones, the first, second edition, because it isn't dice rolling combat, it's card combat, and therefore it's not as random.
Yeah, it gives you more control over
yeah,
the outcome. So most people think that an Ameritrash game must contain a combat or conflict system of some sort. Some notable mentions were Blood Rage and Kemet, and these are examples of what most people would identify as a hybrid game. So taking this combat or conflict system and meshing it with more traditional mechanics of a Euro games. One person, however, felt that it simply cannot be done. The theme is that strong that you can't have a hybrid of the two genres. What do you guys think? And for next time, I'm going to give you a chance to tell me what questions you'd like me to ask. So if you want to put some of those questions in the comments down below, that'd be great. Hopefully you enjoyed Café Chat and enjoy the rest of your lunch.
Hi everybody, welcome to the Hobby Hangout segment of Throat Punch Lunch. I'm Kat Jackson with CK Studios, a professional art and paint studio, and I'm going to talk to you this week a little bit about wet palettes. Our wet palettes are something that we use to maintain or enable us to have a lifespan on our paints so that we're not constantly needing to go back and revisit our paint pots and refill our palettes. If we're using paper plates, it tends to dry out before you're even done with your session. And with hobby painting, we tend to do a lot of blending. We add colors, we mix them up. We're going from lows to mid to high tones. and this enables us to keep our paint range over several days, if not weeks and sometimes months, to capture what colors we're using for our paint projects and also expand the lifetime of our investment into our paints. So there are a couple of kits I want to show you. The first one is the one by Masterson's. I've got a sticker on here from Massive Voodoo, but it comes with paper, and it's a handy palette stay wet paper, and also their sponges. Their sponges are called Handy Palette Sponges, Stay Wets. And you're going to simply get the sponge wet, wring it out again, and put it into the palette itself with a piece of this paper over it. And the paper itself, it's special in that it is permeable, and it allows for water to come up through the paper and not have the paint soak down underneath it very much. So you're not losing your paint, but your paint's staying moist without being wet. This is the one I used as an example in the last segment. I showed you a brief moment on wet palettes. And as you can see here, my paint's still wet. I haven't played with it yet, haven't reconstituted it, but I still have wet paint if I wanted to revisit this from two weeks ago. Another way that we can do this is if you're handy at home and you like to save a little bit of money, you can simply get yourself a nice flat container. You can use a pile of paper towels underneath it, and I have some over here. Get your paper towels wet, stack them up underneath it, and then you're going to take some Reynolds Wrap, and it needs to be Reynolds Wrap. I would highly recommend that. Reynolds Wrap parchment paper cut down to size to fit in your container, and you're going to put that over your wet paper towels, or you can get one of the Masterson Stay Wet palette sponges and cut that down to size in your container. The nice thing about the container that I really, really like is that this tends to be nice and watertight, so if I'm traveling, I don't get water all over my hobby bag. This paint here, as you can see, I'm still able to play with it. This paint, as an example, has been in here for over 6 months. So this is one that it's going to stay nice and airtight. It's going to last you a long time. For very small investment, you can get into this one for under $5. The other sponges that come with Privateer Press, to give an example of a sponge that you can kind of locate yourself if you don't want to use the paper towels. I have cut down sponges that have come out of my Malifaux kits, my resin kits for Malifaux, or my plastic kits for Malifaux, cut them down to size and put those in my plastic containers as well. For traveling, I would recommend, if you're using the Masterson's, it isn't as watertight. You're going to wring out your sponge, put your paper back over it, and then you're going to wrap and seal it in a plastic bag. The Privateer Press one, or the P3 one, tends to be a little more watertight, and you probably won't lose as much water in your hobby bag. So that's this segment of Hobby Hangout. I hope this is a tip and a tool that you can use. If you need any other help or advice with building out something of your own, feel free to reach out to me. I'm enjoying the comments and the feedback, and I'll continue to bring you some tips and tools in the following segments. As we say at CK Studios, come paint with us.
Hey folks, welcome to a new segment I'm going to be doing for Throat Punch Lunch called Accessorize. Just going to be showcasing some different things that you can use to kind of accessorize your hobby, whether it's painting or modeling or whatever it might be. I'm going to try to hunt out some things that will help you do that. The first thing that I've run into is what I'm going to be sharing with you over the next couple of episodes, and that is a modular workstation for painting from Hobby Zone or Broken Table Hobbies, whichever, you know, you take your pick. But let's get to you. Let me show you. So when you buy your Hobby Zone modules or your Broken Table Hobbies modules, it's going to come in a box like this, and it will open up to see a wonderful bunch of bubbles, and then your bubbles will come with a set inside. You know, you've got your instructions here, both sides, how to put everything together. You have to actually glue it together because it does say that it takes wood glue and a hammer. What do you use a hammer for? These little boogers right here are really hard to put in, but it's worth it because the modular system is is really neat and convenient. So anyway, you get it all put together and it looks like what I'm about to show you. Now, the thing that I really, really enjoy about this system is the fact that it's modular. You can take and break stuff apart and you can move it and configure it however you want to configure it. It doesn't really matter. And the really cool thing about it is that it's all magnetized. So if you can see how this kind of just snaps on there, it's because it has magnets, real small magnets on the top here, where you can possibly see where the magnets are going to clip into place. And then of course there's some on the underside of this as well. And it just snaps in there, so you don't have to worry about it shifting off or anything like that. I really like that about this system. You can take, you know, these end caps here and set them on and they just kind of lock into place there, so that you don't have to worry about them tipping over or anything like that. So that's really cool. I really like this system. Hobby Zone and Broken Table Hobbies have a really cool thing going here. This is not everything that I have. This is just what I've built so far. So it's I'll keep you guys up to date. This is going to be something I'm going to show you throughout the next few weeks on Throat Punch Lunch. So tune in next time.
So today, like I said on my last segment, what I planned on doing was comparing Kemet versus Blood Rage, or Blood Rage versus Kemet, however you like to do it. They're both area control games, but I will go into what each has different and their similarities. Alright, so starting with Kemet, pretty obvious difference. Kemet is an Egyptian theme, Blood Rage is a Norse theme. I wrote this all down, so forgive me, I just didn't want to miss any points. I probably still will miss a few, but, you know, go ahead and make your own assumptions or make your own gripes and comments in the comments. Also, I am wearing yellow for Team Instinct, so, you know, go Team Instinct, Pokemon Go. So, also with Blood Rage, you have the Norse gods. But with Kemet, you get the Greek monsters if you have the CK3 expansion, which actually pulls in from Cyclades. Alright, going back down, we have the Tableau building or Tech Tree in Kemet. So, you know, you sit there and you purchase tiles based on what level your pyramids are. However, in Blood Rage, you do card drafting. I know in Kemet, everyone gets a steady hand of cards. They're all the same. The only difference is the colors. However, you can buy that blue or red card, which gives you more attack or more defense. However, in Blood Rage, it's always, always going to be that drafting mechanic. The only thing that I disliked about the drafting mechanic in Blood Rage, sorry Eric, is the rules state that you go every time to the left. Well, in my group, they love to hate draft me because I tend to play the Loki strategy very, very well every time. Even though I don't win, I'm still playing the Loki strategy, so they like to hate draft me. So what we have implemented is the Seven Wonders rule, left, right, left, for the ages. Just a tip for you guys. Going back, these sculpts of the miniatures are highly different. I'm not saying bad things about the sculpts for Kemet. I will say bad things about the sculpts for Dissetti because they were subpar, in my opinion. I liked the mercenaries, however, Syracophinx or whatever she is, I didn't like her sculpt all that much. The ram and the hippo, they really dropped the ball. The first sculpts in this game that the company put out that did them are excellent. I really like them. However, this is a cool mini or not game, so I mean, talking about sculpts and miniatures, this is, you know, not the end all be all, but we're getting pretty far up there. I've talked to, you know, I did an informal poll among my friends about these two games, because most of them I've made play them. They said some of the reasons that they don't like Kemet is the long playtime. And yes, Kemet can be long, especially teaching it to new players. However, Blood Rage, obviously it's a shorter playtime, so everybody likes that. Blood Rage, you're always trying to lose battles, obviously. Kemet, you're trying to win battles. And the variable map, you can flip it over and you get a different map. And this one, actually, I mean, it's a different board each time. It depends on how many people you're playing, and which provinces have been destroyed by Ragnarok, and where you put the actual pillage items. The things that they do have is they both actually have a really good theme. I mean, the Egyptian team fits pretty well with this one, and the Norse theme fits pretty well with this one, with the winning battles and the losing battles. You have variable powers per team. I mean, yes, everyone starts off the same in both of these games, depending on which pyramids you pick, obviously. But you can get the cards that make your teams, and get the skill tokens that make your teams better than someone else's. The equidistance on the maps. Obviously, you have to pay to move to do it in Blood Rage, but everything is pretty much either one or two far, two places away, and that's the same with Kemet. That's one of the reasons why I love both of these games. You don't have to travel too far across the map. Setup time for both of them is kind of difficult, depending on how many players you're playing with, but there are a lot of pieces. Both of them have a similar scoring mechanism, where, you know, you obviously score at the end of the game. However, Kemet, obviously, it's at the end of the day and night phase, so you could get a leader in the middle there. But they did fix that with the Tisseti expansion. Also, the economy between both of the games, you have an economy that you're playing with. It's prayer points for Kemet, rage for Blood Rage. Obviously, I love both of these games. You will never take them away from me, ever. They are mine. So, thanks for watching, and remember, prepare for conflict.
Punchies, I'm Forrest from Bowers Game Corner, and I'm back again for three reasons where I spotlight a game outside of the top 1,000 on BoardGameGeek that I still think you might want to go back and check out. Today I'm very excited to check out Corporate America from Teal Fristo, one of my favorite games of all time. Such a great game, I slapped a Bowers best seal on it. But today I'm going to give you three reasons why you might want to go back and check it out. First and foremost, this game has three completely different phases that you're going to be doing each round, and I like all three of them. You'll start off by building up your business empire as you play business cards down in front of you. And you have choices immediately. Do you want to go for a lot of synergy, which is going to give you huge chunks of change, but is also going to put a giant target on your back? Do you diversify your portfolio, which means you're going to get paid a lot more frequently, but a lot less money, but it will give you a lot of power when it comes to negotiating? Or do you want to get those oh-so-delicious business cards that will give you special perks and bonuses throughout the game? The choice is yours. Next, you'll move on to the Main Street phase, where players are going to be taking turns flipping over business-type cards. If your business type of card gets played, then you get paid. This phase is all about negotiation because everybody wants their business type card to get played, which means lots of wheeling and dealing in this phase. I love it. Last but not least, you're going to get to the presidential election phase, where bills and laws are going to be put onto the board that could potentially go into effect. And these have long-term ramifications on the game sometimes. Presidential candidates will emerge, they will give their pitch on what they're going to do, and then you have a blind bidding auction phase where you hopefully can get the president that's going to do you best elected. Love it. The second reason why I love this game is because it is one of my go-to 5 and 6 player games. Easy to learn, easy to teach, and when you get to the higher player counts, oh, there's so much backstabbing and wheeling and dealing and negotiating. It is awesome. Another great reason why I love this at the higher player counts is because, especially when people know what they're doing, it doesn't add too much time to the length of the game due to how the game is structured, which is always a good thing. The third reason why I think you might like this game is because, in my personal opinion, not too many other games do backstabbing and negotiation better than this game. The negotiation in the Main Street phase is so much fun, as everybody wants to get their business type of card played, and most of the time, you're going to have a horse in the race, so you're going to have a vested interest in what card gets played. There's lots of wheeling, lots of dealing, and lots of kiss stealing in this phase, and I love it. And oh my gosh, don't even get me started on the presidential election phase. The backstabbery in this is the best because people are contributing their hard-earned cash, aka victory points, to getting you elected, and then you can turn around and just say, you know what, all those things I said I'm gonna do, I'm not gonna do them. Man, I love this game. So that is Corporate America from Teal Fristo, a game that I think you might want to go back and check out. If you enjoyed this, let me know in the comments below, and as always, back to more throat punchy goodness.
Hey everyone, this is Tim Jeanette, the Metal Meeple, and this is the Miniature Breakdown. So last episode, I showed you the unique parts of War Machine, and in the next couple episodes, I'm going to show you the different faction choices. The game did release the third edition in rulebook form on the 29th, I believe, a little bit earlier for people at their convention Lock and Load. So if you're wanting to check out the game, maybe this will give you a little bit of insight on the factions. First up, we have Signar. Each faction I'm going to show you here in front of the camera is going to be the battle box that you get at least for MK2. They are slightly different for the third edition of the game. But basically, Signar is the most prosperous faction. They also are the most technologically advanced as far as, especially when it comes to ranged combats. They have tons of ranged in this. If you want to play ranged, this is the faction you pick. Basically, they have melee units that have ranged as well. Their melee units aren't super, they can't take a lot of damage, but they can do a decent amount of damage. And with all that lightning, they can disrupt different ward. They have a spell called, or an ability called Disruption when they hit warjacks, or at least some things have it. When they hit warjacks, they can't be allocated focus, and as I showed you before, focus really amplifies the ability for warjacks to do their damage and their abilities. Now, basically, my personal favorites of this, being that this is my favorite faction, as you can tell by my shirt. First up, we have Siege. Siege is a warcaster. He holds his own in combat, but he also has a really, really cool list of spells. The Defender is a very simple warjack. He basically just has a big gun. I give him a couple focus. He can roll extra dice to hit things, does tons of damage, and he works really well with Siege. The Journeyman Warcaster is another one of my favorites. He's basically like a mini warcaster. He has some focus that he gives out a buff and stuff. And finally, the Arcane Tempest Gun Mages, they are pretty cool. They have different shots that they basically load in their gun, and it's a different ability, but it has options. It's really cool. Now, the next faction we're going to go over is the Protectorate of Minoth. They are the religious practitioners of the Iron Kingdom, and essentially they got mad at Signar or whatever, and they broke off, and they're kind of at war with each other, but you can read the fluff and stuff later. They want to cleanse the world. They want everybody to believe in Minoth, and they set fire to everything. So fire is one of their main things. They set fire on things, and then during your beginning of your next turn, you have to roll to see if it destroys you or if it goes out. They have really powerful warjacks. I mean, really, really powerful warjacks, and even spells that support making them more powerful. The thing is, though, the Protector of Minoth is a little bit of a synergetic faction. You do have to build a list that works really well with each other. When you do that, though, you also have to be peeled like an onion. So people you're going up against have a hard time unless they get rid of certain things in a certain order, because you're just really powerful unless they take them out. So I don't have the models that I think are my favorites, so I'm just going to tell you about them. The Avatar of Minoth is an autonomous warjack. He roams the battlefield just purely driven by faith, and he generates his own focus. The Harbinger of Minoth is a warcaster. She's like a younger girl, but she's so much in faith, she's trying to go up into heaven, so she's kind of like a kite. And they got these guys holding her down with these chains, or, you know, holding it like a balloon or so. And some of the Knights Exemplar, they are pretty neat. They have a brotherhood, which sadly is a brotherhood bond, which is removed in the new edition, but it allows them to basically, if they die, the other ones get stronger. Really cool stuff. Next week, our next episode, we're going to take a look at two more factions for War Machine. And until next time, feel free to contact me at the information below and check out the Meeple Core podcast. And until next time, keep on rocking and rolling dice.
Hey again, everyone. Georgie here. This week, I'm back with the present, and the game that I've chosen is Ice Cool, 2-4 player children's dexterity game, which is designed by Brian Gomez and released by Brain Games. The game itself has a box within a box thing going on, and that just basically means that the box is the board. You clip all these little boards together that's on the inside of this box here to create where you're going to be flicking your penguins around. Now, one penguin will take up the role of as a catcher, and the other three will take up the role of a runner. Now, the runners just need to flick their penguins on their turn, hopefully try and angle them through certain doorways where you get your little fish tokens, and the catcher is just trying to flick his penguin and catch the others. Now, for every other penguin that the catcher gets, he gets to take their identity card. Now, the end of the round is triggered when one player gets all his fish tokens, and then players will, if you're the runners, draw fish cards, which have a number of points on the back of them, which range between 1 and 3. and they will draw those cards for every fish token that they have, and the catcher will draw cards for every identity card that he has, meaning that even if he catches no one on his turn, he still gets to draw one card. Now, with the points kind of being like between 1 and 3 on the back of the cards, the winner of the game can be very random. Even if you feel like you've done a lot better than another player, but you get a load of 1 cards, then you will kind of feel a little screwed over at that point, I guess. But the game is just for fun, and it is just that, a fun children's dexterity game. And it's really fun to try and jump your penguins too, so you can like flick them on the top and they can like jump over walls. But then if the runner figures out how to do that, or sorry, the catcher figures out how to do that, that can become pretty frustrating when you think you're quite far away from them and you're not going to be able to get caught. But anyway, that's the present, and next time I'm going to be back with the future.
Hi, welcome to Miniatures World. This week we're going to be covering something very dear to my heart. Miniatures. This is Miniatures World, right? Well, anyways, there's a lot of different miniatures out there. A lot of different types. And sometimes people don't understand why they get a certain type of miniature in a box set and another type of miniature in another box set, and there's such a difference in price. We're going to try to explain some of that in this week's segment. So let's go down to the table and take a look at some of the miniatures I pulled out and talk about the difference in between each one. So as you can see on the table here, I have a varying difference of different types of models, and I'm going to explain each one to you. Now, the first is an ejection mold, okay? You'll find this in most of your board games. To make a board game affordable, you can use a cheaper plastic and inject into a mold and get something like this. It doesn't hold up with a lot of detail, but as you can see, it's very cheaper plastics and flimsy, but it's there so it can make board games affordable. If you really tried to put 100 miniatures into one board game plus with all the components, your board games would probably be about $200-$300, and you really don't want that. So you've got to cut somewhere, and a lot of times it's either smaller cards and cheaper miniatures, or if the miniature is such an important part of the game, they'll go to another type of plastic. Take like your Silver Tower, which is a very expensive game, but your miniatures are absolutely top of the line, no bend in them, made with a very, very good hard plastic, and they carry a lot of detail because the molds are a lot more expensive. Remember, the more expensive mold, the more it's going to get passed down to you. And here's just another blue horror from Silver Tower. Now, there's also what they call is metal casting, or pewter casting. In the old days, it was common. Even GW Games Workshop did it. And now you find it more in your armor tanks and your old battleships and stuff like this. And how this was done was that the metal was actually poured while there was a mold that was spinning around, and the hot metal would go in and the force would push it into the mold, thus forcing out any air, and it would spin until it cools, and then you would separate it. Expensive process, but back in the day it was quite popular and very good. Finally, there is resin casting, and as you can see, used still today by Spartan Games, and very solid, very hard. It's two compound chemicals that come together and very quickly dry, and boom, you know, right in the mold. So now you know all the different types of miniatures, and if you remember, the last one I said was resin. So what are we going to do here next week? Well, we're going to duplicate some miniatures, and it's actually going to be a lot of fun. I'm going to show you guys at home how to make your own resin, and it's very easily done. We're going to build a mold, and it's going to be a silicone mold. So next segment, we're going to be working and building our own models. So I hope you guys will join me, and I'll show you how to do some resin casting. Until next time, thanks so much for watching Miniature World and everybody else on Throat Punch Lunch. They're doing such a wonderful job. We'll see you next time. I'm Rob Warren. And guys, have a great couple weeks.
So that is the third episode of Throat Punch Lunch. I want to thank all of my contributors. They're doing such a good job at staying on time and staying committed and dedicated to making segments for this show. And I want to thank you guys, the listeners as well, because you're taking the time out of your busy schedule to watch us talk about a hobby that we really do enjoy, probably as much or more than you do. So until next time, we'll see you on the flip side. And hey, watch out for those throw punches.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.